Hello, and welcome to today's Live Writer's Digest webinar titled Copywriting Revealed. Learn how you can make a good living as a writer and publish your book at the same time with co-founder Katie Yackel, independent copywriter and consultant Bob Bly, and copywriter and author Pat McCord, along with Rebecca Matter answering questions. Katie Yackel has spent over 30 years in the world of direct marketing and publishing in the roles of copy editor, editorial coordinator, product manager, fulfillment supervisor, marketing manager, and publisher. Bob Bly is an independent copywriter and consultant with 35 years of experience in business-to-business, high-tech, industrial, and direct marketing. If you've got something to sell, Bob will find a way to do it. That's why it comes as no surprise that he's one of the most successful copywriters working today. And then we have Pat McCord. She is both an author and a copywriter working from her home office in Tucson, Arizona. She is perhaps best known for her novels for juveniles, one of which won numerous literary awards and was considered for a TV after-school special. Okay, with that, Katie, I'm just going to let you take it from here, and I'm going to go on mute. I won't jump in unless you need me to.
Okay, well, thanks so much, Sue. And Bob and Pat, now it's good for you to unmute your phones as well, and we'll get started.
Okay.
Thank you.
Great. Thank you all for joining us today. The name of this webinar is Copywriting Revealed. And the reason we're going to spend the next hour talking about copywriting is it's the best way I know of and our guests know of to make a good living, of being able to support yourself and your family while continuing to work on your book projects. My guess is that's important to you or you wouldn't be with us. So let's get started. Okay. So, our goals for today. We're going to hear about what a typical day is like from two very successful copywriters, and as Writer's Digest subscribers, you're probably familiar with them. We're going to hear, you know, how does it actually work? How is it possible to have these two different careers that support each other so well and still have a balanced life as well? We're going to show you how you can leverage your current writing talent into highly paid writing projects. And then we're going to talk about what are realistic time and income expectations for you if you were to get started as a copywriter right now. We're going to show you how to set yourself up so you're writing about things you're most interested in. And then as a bonus, you're going to get tips from our special guests for getting your book published. I appreciate Sue's introduction of me. I'm Katie Yackel, AWAI co-founder and executive director. I'm a marketer with over 30 years experience in the publishing industry. I'm the publisher of the industry's leading training programs on copywriting and building a successful writing business. I've spent the last 20 years helping writers launch successful writing careers. And if you're not familiar with my company, American Writers and Artists, Inc., we've been helping writers live the writer's life since 1997. We are the publisher of the Accelerated Program for Six-Figure Copywriting, the industry's definitive program on writing direct response copy. And we pride ourselves on not only giving you the skills necessary to be a well-paid writer, but also the tools and access necessary to find clients and build a successful writing business. I'm thrilled to have our special guest with us, Bob Bly, master copywriter, author of 85 published books, Pat McCord, freelance copywriter, author of 15 published books. Welcome, Bob. Welcome, Pat.
Thanks for having us.
Bob, is there anything else you'd like to add to this introduction at the start of this call for our listeners?
No, but I want everyone on the call to appreciate that I'm here despite the fact that we're having a flood in our weekend house that I'd like to get to, but I'm going to stay here.
Thank you, Bob. We do appreciate that. Pat, how about you?
I guess I would just say generally that copywriting has worked out really well for me after working in the corporate world. I worked at Boeing and Microsoft, and during those times I was writing at night and weekends, and that's all. So this has allowed me to do...
Hello?
Kat?
Both.
Oh.
She glitched out for a minute.
We lost that. All right. Well, okay. Kat?
Yes.
Kat, are you there?
Oh, we lost
her. Yes, I'm here.
She's here.
Oh, I can't. Can you hear me? Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, great. All right. We all have to take a breath here, I think, and hopefully no more acts of God or technical problems. So you're going to be hearing a lot more from Bob and Pat throughout the next hour or so. I'd also like to introduce my partner at AWAI, Rebecca Matter. As AWAI's president, Rebecca has hired and trained hundreds of copywriters. There's nobody who knows more about this industry, the marketing that goes on, the writing that's needed, and there's nobody who's a bigger champion of writers than Rebecca. So I'm thrilled that she's with us to answer the questions throughout the webinar. She'll be very busy in the chat box, I have a feeling.
Thank you, Katie.
Oh, you're welcome. All right. So we're going to get started with just a overreaching definition of copywriting. I think of it as persuasive writing. And Bob, I'm interested on how you describe it.
There are several definitions, but the simplest is copywriting is writing advertising. That's it.
Right. That's what it is. And now when we talk about copywriting, though, we talk about writing that's different than traditional advertising writing. You know, ordinary advertising creates awareness, but copywriting gets people to take an action. You know, we're all about direct response. And, you know, some of the characteristics are that, you know, this type of writing targets one reader at a time. It drives that person to take an action, like buy something, sign up for a newsletter, click on a link, donate to a charity. And the really big thing is that each action is trackable, so results are measurable. Bob, anything to add to that?
Well, there are two types of advertising. One is what's called general or image advertising or branding, which is, as you say, builds awareness of a product, but it doesn't ask for the order directly. You see a commercial for Burger King, you can't call up and have a burger delivered. But for a direct response ad, like if you've seen these insurance ads for the general, they give you an 800 number and say, call for a free quote on an insurance policy. That's direct response. It asks for a direct action, which is either to place an order or to make an inquiry to ask for more information.
Exactly. And now, why, in your opinion, are direct response writers in such high demand?
It's very simple. The results of our work can be measured in terms of dollars generated almost down to the penny. Therefore, we can prove to the client that we have generated a high return on their investment. A lot of general or brand advertising is amorphous. You say, well, I like that commercial. It's funny. It's creative. But did it make any money? Often the general marketers, advertisers, like Kellogg's and Ivory Soap, they can't tell. And so they are more reluctant to pay freelancers big dollars for this.
Exactly. And plus, when you think about it, direct response advertising, direct response copywriting is everywhere. It's a $2.3 trillion industry. You know, it's the lifeblood of companies. It's what they use to sell their products or services. And, you know, with things changing so quickly, appetite being so hungry for so much information, these companies constantly need a new stream, a steady diet of copy. They need it for their websites, for their e-letters, for their sales letters, for their catalogs. You know, the list just goes on. And the reality is that a well-written sales letter, you know, can bring in, you know, hundreds of thousands, even millions of dollars into a company. And, you know, if you're the writer that does that, they're very happy to pay you for it, and they're very, you know, eager to get you signed up for the next project. So, Bob, one last question on this topic, and then we'll get into the specific goals for today. You know, why is it that, you know, aside from the reasons that we just laid out here, why is direct response copywriting such a valuable skill for writers to have?
It's very simple. Supply and demand. As you just said, the demand for direct response copy that can make the cash register ring, is the expression we use, is at an all-time high, largely because of the internet. But the number of copywriters or writers that can actually know how direct response works, know the principles and rules, because more so than general advertising, it is based on known and proven and tested principles. The number of writers who know those is very small, so we can sort of command our own fees.
That's great. And how would you say, you know, understanding the principles of direct response copywriting, persuasive writing, has helped you in your other writing enterprises?
I would say, well, one of the things, and we could talk about that question for 40 minutes, but one of the things is direct response copy tends to usually have a simple, use simple, plain language, short words, short sentences, short paragraphs, and I've used that style in my other writings. And I once had a journalist read a newspaper article I wrote, and she says, "Oh, I love this style. It's, you know, it's so crisp, it's so easy, and it's the direct response style." But I didn't tell her that.
Pat, how about you? How have you found that learning copywriting has helped your other writing?
Oh, absolutely. Can you hear me okay?
Yes.
Okay. The fact that I knew how to face a blank screen was one thing. I'm a self-starter. You're all self-starters. I already knew my way around words, so it actually helped me with the fiction that I was writing. And I learned it very, very quickly.
Great, great, great. Well, we're going to get into that when a little bit later in the call, just what those realistic time frames are. But first, I would like to bring people inside. You know what a typical. Oh dear. Sue, I may need a little bit of hand
just
here.
Just go to slideshow and start
just,
from current.
Yeah,
top,
go up to the top to the slideshow.
Okay,
slide
from current slide.
There you go.
Gotcha. Thanks. Okay, let's move into a day in the life of a copywriter. Pat, tell us about what a typical day for you is like.
Okay, writers by definition are kind of sedentary. I live in a canyon, so every morning I'm out there walking to the bottom and back up. I do that first. Then the mornings are for my fiction, and in the afternoons I do copywriting. And sometimes if I have a deadline, I work into the evening, even at night. I go to bed early with books. I do not set an alarm, and I get up and do the same thing the next morning.
Sounds ideal. Bob, how about you? I know you are a workaholic who has many, many projects going on, but what would you say your typical day is like?
It's very simple. I get up at 5 o'clock in the morning. I don't do anything except walk down one flight of steps to my office. I turn on the computer, and I type and work. It's not all just typing. It's reading. It's talking on the phone with clients. And I type and work till 5 in the afternoon or so. It's a 12-hour day, and I do it 5 days a week. I also usually put in some hours early Saturday morning, because getting up at 5 every day, you can't sleep late in the weekends. I might sleep till 6 or 7 on a weekend, but not later than that.
Right. And so how much time do you spend on book projects out of that day? Like, how much is copywriting? How much is...
Unlike Pat, who spends the mornings writing books, books are a side venture for me. My business, to which I'm dedicated, is copywriting. So I would say 80 to 90% of my time is spent copywriting. And when I'm done, which I start the day with, but if I tend to peter out in the afternoon, let's say it's 3 o'clock, it's 3:30, and I've just done as much as I can on a big project and I don't feel like starting another, I'll open up a file for one of my books. I usually am writing multiple books at one time, and I'll treat myself to work on the book for an hour or two.
So that's a treat for you.
It's the for me, writing books is easier than writing copy. It's less intense, so that's my relaxation.
That's wonderful. So this goes, you know, back to this question we already touched on, and I think that the fact that that is your relaxation, I would venture to say that it's copywriting that is your copywriting skills has helped you get to that state. Is there any other ways you feel that being a copywriter has helped you be more successful in your book writing?
Well, this may seem an odd thing to say, but I know a lot. I have a lot of writer friends who write books and plays and short stories, and a lot of them spend a lot of time worrying about money. With copywriting, making an income in the multiple six figures, writing is not a concern. So if I'm writing a book, I would love it to be a bestseller, but if it's not, it doesn't affect me one way or the other. Copywriting is really how I make my money. Books are an avocation and a secondary source of income. So I'm not under financial pressure like I would be if I was a full-time book author to make money from book writing and other nonfiction I do and fiction.
Right. That's wonderful. Pat, how about you?
It just depends. Recently, I did a 100-day challenge for a novel I was working on. It was called Murder in Waves, and I wrote the rough draft in less than 100 days, and then I wanted to do some research, so I went and met up with a former champion surfer in Huntington Beach, California, and while I was there, during the afternoons in the hotel, I did my copywriting work. So, you know, it kind of gets mixed up a little bit. My schedule just depends on what's going on at the time, but the neat thing is that I can do that.
Right. So having copywriting has given you that flexibility to be able to devote the time needed to your fiction writing and your book writing.
That's right. And right now I'm trying to market a book. I'm shopping it with my agent. And so right now I'm not working on fiction, at least not today or tomorrow probably.
Right. And I bet I'm sure the persuasive skills that make your sales letters work are being put to use in the query letters you're writing or the correspondence that you're having with publishers to get their attention.
Oh, it's immeasurably helpful. I always, you know, one of the big things that I took from copywriting into my fiction writing was that I got much more to the point, which you have to do in copywriting. And I was meandering all over the place with descriptions, and I'm cured. I'm forever cured because of copywriting.
Congratulations. All right. Now, with copywriting, you know, it is you're working for clients, and for some writers that's not an appealing process at all. So I do want to get your take on that. A little bit later we'll talk about how to get these clients, but I just want to, you know, again, since we're looking at kind of the lifestyle and quality of life, how does that factor into your job satisfaction, quote unquote, of being a copywriter? Bob, let's start with you.
Well, some copywriters you talk with seem to have a negative attitude toward clients, an almost adversarial relationship, and their complaint is that, well, I write something and the client changes it. I don't have that attitude. I don't have an adversarial relationship. I have great relationships with most of my clients, with really all of the ones I've kept. Some of them have become friends. So I like having clients. I like the fact that clients give me assignments. You know, today someone
sure.
said, I need you to write an ad, a full-page ad, on an anti-wrinkle cream. I just love that. And then he said, I need it in 2 weeks, so I have a deadline. And he gave me the subject matter. So, you know, I enjoy the rigor and the discipline of working for clients. So it's not a problem for me.
Great. Pat, how about you?
Well, I have to admit I am by definition almost a little bit of a loner. So I too was a little intimidated by this at first, but I have developed what I call the friendship method, and that is I do sort of become friends with the clients I have. And one example is right here in my city of Tucson, a physician who had a product needed to launch that product. So I wrote quite a few pieces for them. But he's also a great reader of sci-fi. So he and I share information about new books we've read and that kind of thing. And I've had lunch with his wife a couple of times. I mean, it's just kind of fun.
Sure, sure. So it takes kind of the pressure off of the, you know, big bad client, quote unquote. And yeah, and you're helping a friend out. You know, what could be better than that? I do want to move into leveraging, you know, current writing talents into highly paid writing projects. So, Bob, what would you say your best practices are for that?
Well, I like to specialize in a few different areas. I mean, I'm also a generalist. You know, any good project that comes along that someone will hire me, if I like it, I'll do it. But I tend to focus my copywriting in a few niches, and I'm careful. I do it by things that interest me, that I like. I have to be intellectually stimulated, or I can't do it. But within that, I then gravitate towards niches that pay well. For example, I do a lot, as many AWAI graduates do, in the health field, specifically nutritional supplements. I like doing it, and it pays very well. There are other areas of copywriting that, frankly, don't usually pay that well, and I try to avoid those. Pat was very lucky with her doctor, but one of the markets I tell writers to avoid is working for small professional firms, lawyers, doctors, and so on, chiropractors. Usually, you know, they don't pay the big fees that a major manufacturer of nutritional supplements or a manufacturer of medical equipment will pay you.
Great. Pat, any best practices for you on this topic?
I think I go at it a little bit differently, and I'm not saying that I do it the right way necessarily. In fact, I'm one of these people who's made every mistake in the book. I did not choose a niche right away. That was a mistake. Probably Bob is very right about most small chiropractors, dentists, people like that, because they're paying you out of their own pocket in a way, and it's a little bit harder to get the good fees from them. So I kind of went at it, and what happened is jobs came to me. I'm a terrible marketer. The jobs kept coming to me, which meant that sometimes I was doing jobs that weren't as much fun as others. So I'm really working now on zeroing in on a niche, finally, after a number of years.
Okay. And, you know, so many people have so much life experience that they don't realize can translate into writing projects. If there's something that they're interested in, something that they've been involved in, something that they have experience in, hobbies, you know, life, you know, so many things. 99.9% of the time, there is a copywriting market for whatever that interest is. Could be blog posts, it could be, you know, websites, it could be product sales, it could be just memberships, that, you know, or, you know, forums and things like that. So I always encourage people to write. Start with, you know, what are the websites you go to? What are the products that you buy? What are the things that you're interested in, your hobbies, your interests? And then just look to see where conversations are happening and look to see where you have something to add to that conversation. And as writers, you know, that's easier than somebody who doesn't have that that natural tendency to do that. But then once you get your foot in the door of these, you know, showing that you – excuse me? Oh, I'm sorry. I thought I heard something. You know, that's just a great way of leveraging, you know, what you're currently doing, what you're currently interested in into writing projects. So now I want to move on to setting realistic time and income expectations. So, Bob, let's start with you. What would you say, how long will it take for someone who loves to write to learn how to write direct response copy?
Well, when you asked this of me, when we talked before, I looked at my own situation. In 1981, I had a corporate job as an advertising manager, and I was earning $27,000 a year, which people may laugh at when they hear that. But back then, for someone who was just out of college, that was a good
salary.
That was
good.
That was a good salary. So the next year, I became a full-time freelance in 1982, and I wasn't always busy. I would say I was not that successful my first year of freelancing, but when I counted it up at the end of the year, I had made $39,000, so maybe 30% more than my staff job. So really, you can be successful the first year, but I think the ideal situation is to have enough money. You know, I'm not saying you have to do it, but to have enough money, a cushion, enough money in the bank, that if you made zero your first year, you wouldn't lose your house or not be able to pay your rent. I didn't have
good
that
advice.
Situation. Yeah, I didn't have that situation, but that's if I was doing it over, I might do that.
Right. And Pat, how long did it take you? You said you were a little bit slower getting started.
Well, actually, I got the course. I went through it in about 2 weeks, and then my husband coerced me to go to boot camp, and after that, I did my first job pro bono without getting paid for it, and that became my first sample, and within a very short time, because of that first sample, I had paying work. So, you know, I did not do copywriting full time. I was writing my books at the same time. I had a new contract for a book. I was doing speaking jobs that also paid me. So I did have that cushion. So I was making money copywriting really fast within a couple of months.
That's wonderful. And how long do you said you went through our program, which we'll be talking about a little bit later, in 2 weeks, which is very quick, I must say. But how... Do you think what do you think is a realistic time to learn the structure of a sales letter to be able to make the sales letters that generate results for people?
Well, one thing I did, I first, when I say 2 weeks, I read through the program, so I knew what it was. Then I went back through. I started a file cabinet of promos I got in the mail or ones that I signed up for. So I already had that background, and I was studying them and making notes on them and all that. I did every single thing the program asked me to do. If it asked me to copy an ad 4 times, I did that. So I was not great at first. My first assignment I sent in, I got beaten up rather badly over it. But then I got it, and by the beginning of the second year, I was making money, but at the beginning of the second year, I was doing pretty well. And in fact, that second year, I won your 10K Challenge Award.
You did.
I did.
You did. Yes, that's okay. So that's not unheard of. You know that to start working that quickly, and the big thing is that the skills are always improving. You never know it all, and Bob, I'm sure you can attest to that. You know, there's always something new to learn. There's always new formats working, new approaches, new ideas, and with the appetite for so much copy that's needed today, there is this influx of the need to keep on top of your game and keep learning. Do you have anything to add to that?
Yeah, I say people ask me, how long does it take to learn direct response copywriting? I said, here's the answer. A few weeks and the rest of your life. You can get to a very primitive level by reading our course, AWAI course, or my book or other books. There's stuff out there. You can learn it. But you can be competent, but not great. The other answer is that Malcolm Gladwell and Mark Ford say if you do something for 1,000 hours, you get good at it, and if you do it for 10,000 hours, you become a master of it.
True.
So the way to learn direct response or any other kind of writing is you read a lot of it, and you do a lot of it. And then you study it.
I agree. That's great advice. Now, Bob, you're
Katie?
A master at, yes?
I wanted to add something. Can I jump in?
Oh, absolutely.
Okay. One of the things I did that helped immeasurably, the first online class I took with AWAI, out of those people, I picked 5 or 6 members and asked them if they wanted to be in a mastermind group. And then we spent the next year writing headlines and leads every morning. And if you don't know what a headline and lead is, folks, you will soon find out. And I wrote hundreds of them.
That's the ideal situation. I hope every AWAI member is listening takes that advice, because that is the surest way to just work those muscles, get those muscles working, and have it become a automatic thing. And the other thing is, once you get into this, it's so fun, because everything you see, you're going to start thinking in terms of copy. It really changes your perspective on, you're going to be thinking about how the, you know, wondering why, oh, I wonder why the copywriter chose this approach instead of that approach, or I wonder if this would work or that would work, or isn't this interesting how they're doing that? And it is this constant enrichment of these ideas, and you just see them in your life, you know, really everywhere you turn. Bob, I want to spend a few minutes because, you know, we touched on this, but just briefly, about how new copywriters, you know, best practices for new copywriters to actually get started. You know, Pat mentioned her friendly strategy and kind of easing into it that way. But I know that this is one of the biggest obstacles or fears. And since you are the master at this, if you could just spend a few minutes giving us some of your best suggestions.
Are you, Katie, are you talking about actually getting clients or something else?
Yeah, actually getting clients.
Well, if you want to talk about getting clients, there's two basic methods, and you should do both. One is establishing your reputation as a skilled expert copywriter, and there's various ways to do that. When I started, one of the things I did is I gave talks on copywriting to local associations whose members were potential clients for me. And when someone hears you give a talk on a subject, they view you as an expert on the subject. So that's one thing I did. Another one is, there was a magazine since defunct called Business Marketing that my potential clients read, and so I approached them and started writing articles, how-to articles on marketing and direct marketing and copywriting, and that helped establish my reputation as an expert. So the first method is to establish yourself as a guru or an expert. The second thing is to use direct marketing to get clients. I launched my business by writing a one-page sales letter and mailing it out to 500 creative directors at ad agencies that handled the type of industrial accounts that I wanted to write for. And I had never written a letter before. At my two corporate jobs, I did not write sales letters. I sent out this letter to 500 creative directors. I got 35 responses back, and out of that, I got the $39,000 worth of business that was my first year. So you can use direct mail to get clients. You can, and now with the internet, there's so many other ways. You can use content. Content marketing is very big. Putting up an ad and offering a special report on how to write industrial copy or how to write for nutritional supplements. People will download that, and those people who ask for that, some of them are prospects for your service. So this is a big topic. And Katie, you know that I wrote an entire book on this called Secrets of a Freelance Writer, which is available on Amazon. Shameless plug.
Yep. No, go for it. It's I highly recommend it. Now, I want to get to questions. I want to be sure we have enough time for questions. And we have touched on these things just throughout our conversation, but I want to come back to just this one last point. And see if either of you have anything to add on, you know, how our writers can transition the current skills they have into the things that they're most interested in and start making money from that. So just if there's anything else to wrap that subject up, because I want to be sure we cover it well.
Well, I'll give you an example, unless Pat wants to go first. I decided when computers became popular that I would write for software and hardware and computer-related stuff, part of it because it interested me, but I was also getting a lot of requests for that. My degree was in chemical engineering, had nothing to do with computers, so I looked for computer training, and I took training, and I got certified as an IT professional. It was called a certified Novell administrator, and so I gave myself a credential. Therefore, when computer people called me about copy, they would challenge me, well, what do you know about computers? And I said three words, I'm a CNA. And that completely erased any objection they had, and they were ready to hire me.
And that's great. The beauty of it. Any job experience you have, if you're, you know, you're a yoga teacher and you want to write about, you know, those type of products, what better credibility? If you're a nurse, if you're a teacher, you know, whatever your life experience has been, there's a way of doing what Bob just said that makes sense for the target, to the clients that you're targeting, that'll ring a bell, say, oh, this is somebody that gets us. This is somebody who knows how to talk to our customers. That's great. Bob or Pat, anything from you on this?
Well, my background was with being a writer for Boeing and Microsoft, and at Microsoft I worked game products. It had nothing whatsoever to do with anything I was copywriting, but the fact that I did that seems to get me some points. An example here in my city of Tucson, when I moved here 12 years ago, I bought a great big old telescope. And it's really too much telescope for me, but I was determined to learn how to use it. But I was totally intimidated about going to the star parties and things like that, because this is an astronomy town and everybody knew so much more than me. So I'm marketing the idea of doing newsletters and things like that for beginners, because that's where I'm at. And, you know, those are the new customers. The beginners are the new customers, not the astronomers.
Right, right, right. But right, you have this affinity. You can ask the questions that they may be asking. You get that they may be intimidated, but you still have the passion and the desire to learn. So I just want to encourage everyone to think kind of outside of you know what you may think a traditional writer or a traditional copywriter is, and just really look within the things that you're doing that you're most passionate about, and see where that leads you. Because I bet you it's gonna there's going to be copywriting opportunities along that way. We promised everybody a special bonus. All of our listeners wouldn't have joined us if they weren't interested in having a book published, since that was such a big promise of this call. Bob, any tips for our listeners for getting books published?
Well, I could talk for a day about this. I suspect Pat could too. And in fact, I have talked for a day about it at full-day seminars in book publishing. So my first question to the listeners would be, what does getting a book published mean? And to you, Katie, do you mean getting a book published by McGraw-Hill, John Wiley, and a traditional publisher? That's a different process than publishing a Kindle ebook and selling it on Amazon. So first, or self-publishing a paper-bound book. So which one are we talking about?
Let's talk traditional publishing to start.
First thing, and see if Pat agrees, you need a literary agent. It is very difficult to reach traditional publishers if you are not represented by the agent, because they're very skeptical when you propose or send in a book, and you really want to propose a book, not send it in. They're very skeptical. And if the agent is representing it, an agent they know, they say, well, it can't be terrible if he or she is taking this on. We should at least look at it. If you do it, they don't have that level of vetting, and they're very reluctant. So I've always been represented, always, by a literary agent.
Okay. Pat, what about you?
Well, I suspect nonfiction and fiction are very different animals. When I first started publishing, I had the same editor. I had the same publishing house, Athenaeum, for years. But the world has changed a lot. And nowadays, it's possible that your publisher will take 10 months, a year, 2 years to let you know if they want the book. And it might be several years before it actually is on the shelf. So I think a decision has to be made in there somewhere. Like Bob says, what publishing means to you. If it's the big prize at the end of having a traditional publisher, then that's what you need to go after. And I, too, have always had agents. But right now, I might consider doing a book myself on Kindle. I'm getting a little older. I don't want to wait 5 years. And it isn't always five, but it's usually quite a while. I may very well do that. And I think there are a lot of good books anymore that are not getting published because there aren't as many slots as there used to be. And things are just taking so long. However, I would give this one caveat. If you decide to go with Kindle or one of those platforms, hire an editor. Because, you know, even though maybe your wife or a friend is pretty good with grammar, you've got to hire a good editor because you don't want to put out garbage. If you don't know an editor, drop me a line. I'm at mccordcopy.com. Drop me a line and I'll tell you who I use. And I may do that in the future. I haven't decided for sure yet, but I think it has more credibility than it used to.
Well, sure. These guys have to make a decision. Now, we're talking to people, the Writer's Digest audience. They've read a lot of already, remember, on how to publish a book, both self-publish and traditional publishing. So you have to, what you really have to do, guys, is make a decision. What I think going to a traditional publisher, let's talk about nonfiction for a second. Going to a traditional publisher, and we can talk about fiction in a minute, going to a traditional publisher is better for nonfiction if you're writing that book to establish your authority as a professional. If you're a psychologist and you want to build your practice and you write a book on relationships, it'll have more credibility if it's published by Random House than if you do it yourself. On the other hand,
I agree.
Yeah. On the other hand, some people, as Pat said, it's very difficult to get a traditional book, and some people may just say, I want a book, and I don't want to wait 2 years, or I don't want to struggle and be rejected. If the important thing is for you to have a book, you can self-publish it as a Kindle book. And by the way, with Amazon's CreateSpace service, if you have a Kindle book on Amazon, there's another button that gives the buyer an option to get it as a paperback. So you're automatically also a paperback book author. It's just self-published. So if you need it right away or you need it fast for any reason, that's one reason to do it Kindle. The reason to self-publish it outside of Kindle and go to a short or long-run book printer and get yourself publish a paper-bound book is that you want to either use it as a marketing tool, like giving it away, or you're a speaker and you want to sell it at the back of the room. That'll give you a better margin than Kindle and CreateSpace.
Okay. And also, if you do go the self-publishing route, I bet copywriting skills come in so beautifully there because it does help you create persuasive writing that, you know, it helps you drive people to your book. It gives you tools and an understanding of how to create some interest, how to write a blog, how to create a little bit of a buzz, you know, through social media. That's all copywriting. That all points in that direction, and that does help as gives you leverage when you're going really either of those routes, but particularly with self-publishing. Well, I want to wrap up because I want to be sure we get to any questions that we may have. But to go back to the theme of our call, which was copywriting revealed and how you can make a good living as a writer and publish your book at the same time. I hope we've covered it sufficiently and given you some good action items that you can get started with. I do want to invite everybody to really think about starting copywriting. Become a copywriter. Add it to your tool belt. Let it give you the freedom and flexibility that it's given Bob and Pat, And if you're ready to get started, I highly recommend our accelerated program for six-figure copywriting. It's professional training taught by many of the best copywriters in the world. Pat took this program. Bob contributed to this program. There's loads of exercises and assignments to ensure you learn the core concepts. There's access to over 50 winning examples of copy written by copywriting legends. You'll learn the same proven techniques, tips, and strategies that have sold billions of dollars of products and services. Plus, you'll even get help building your business. You know, there's a full section of the program dedicated to helping you get clients. We take this very seriously. We know we give people the skills they need. We have no doubt that what we teach prepares people. But we also know that it's just as important for them to have help and guidance and motivation and everything that goes along with the business building part. So we spend just as much time and effort and our resources in helping you build the business as we do in helping you build the skills. You're going to have access to our proprietary directresponsejobs.com website. It's an exclusive job board for AWAI trained copywriters. There's also a special bonus report, How to Safely and Quickly Change Careers, everything you need to embark on your new and exciting copywriting journey. So you can get all this by clicking on this link, www.awaionline.com/writersdigestspecial. Oh, and there is one more bonus that's so valuable and so appreciated by the people in the program, and that's feedback on your writing. So you know you're not doing this in a vacuum. It's not just you get the program and then you're on your own. There's two assignments in the program that are critiqued. The first one is fairly early, just to make sure you understand the basics, and then by the end of the program, you have written a full direct mail package, gone through all the elements, and you get a full critique on that. You write and submit each for review. You get feedback on how to improve it. And then the other beauty of this is once it's done, it's a sample. You can show that you understand how to write a sales letter. So, again, the link is www.awaionline.com/writersdigestspecial. And we do have a special for the listeners of this call. If for the next week, if you sign up, you'll save $300. You pay just $197, which is 60% off. But you do need to sign up today or within the next week at the latest. Just going to give that link one more time, www.awaionline.com/writersdigestspecial. I want to thank you, Bob, Pat, thank you so much for all this great information. And click on the link or please feel free to call our member services team, Leah Daffodil Ortea, 866-879-2924. And now I see we have about 10 minutes. So, Rebecca, are there any questions?
My goodness, this group is awesome. I have answered so many questions. My right hand is physically aching right now. The first one, there's a lot of stuff about publishing. I'm able to answer a lot of the copywriting questions, but for both Pat and Bob, since you do work on both types of projects, do you find it easy to navigate between your different writing projects to switch from copywriting to fiction writing and then back again? I guess Bob will start with you.
I find book writing is the perfect complement to a copywriting business. As I explained it, I write copy, which is the heavy lifting of my day. Start at 5 and maybe at 2, 3, 4 o'clock when I start to peter out, like I will probably in a half hour from now. I'll say, all right, I don't want to start. It's late in the day. I don't want to start another big copywriting project. Let me open up a file and have fun with the book. So to me, they are perfect complements. They do not compete with each other in any way for me.
And Pat, what about you?
Yeah, I agree. It's the perfect combination. I cannot write fiction all day long. I cannot write copy all day long. So it's perfect. And when I'm traveling, I tend to work on copy, even if, like I said earlier, I'm researching something for my fiction book. So it perfect combination.
Excellent. Let's see. A lot of this is about editors. They're talking about getting literary agents, how difficult it is. I guess, do either of you have any tips for those who are still set on getting an agent and having their book published the old-fashioned way, Bob?
Well, if you want to do that, I have to tell you, it is difficult to get an agent. Agents are a buyer's market. Writers need and want them more than they need and want you. The best one trick, not the best way, one trick is go to a bookstore and find a book similar in style and nature to the book you want to write. You know, maybe it's you're writing a big social issue book. Find a hardcover social issue book. Look in the acknowledgments. 8 times out of 10, the author thanks their agent. You can find that agent online, and when you contact them, say, hey, I noticed you were the agent for book XYZ by author ABC. I'm writing a book in a similar vein but on a different topic. And then you describe it. And the fact that you know that they're the agent for that book, they will pay 30 seconds of attention to you rather than instantly reject you as they otherwise would do.
That's awesome. Great tip. Pat, do you have anything else to add or a different way?
Well, I got my first agent long, long ago, and she called me after a really great review came out. After that, one thing would lead to another, and somebody would know somebody would know somebody, and it worked like that for me.
Very cool. So this one is about your copywriting assignments. I'd like for each of you to share with us how much. Somebody asked a question about researching. Do you have to do a lot of researching? Do you have to do a lot of reading? Can you give me a breakdown as to your time spent? So, Bob, if you're working on a project, how much of your time is put into researching versus writing, and do you have any methods for that?
Of course, you do the research first. If you want to know how I research an assignment that actually is posted on my website, if you go to bly.com and click on the button methodology, you'll see it. But in terms of time, 30% to 40% or more of my time is research. The client supplies a lot of the material, but you have to go beyond what they supply. So some of it is looking for it, and then the rest is reading and absorbing it. I take a shortcut that AWAI recommends. I use a freelance online researcher to do a lot of my online research. And then the rest of the time, 50%, 60%, 65%, 70%, is spent doing the writing, and then more important than that, the rewriting, the many drafts that you go through until you get copy that you think is good enough to show the client.
And Pat, what about you? What is your process like?
Well, the first thing I do is ask the client to send me materials they have and let me know if there are things they liked or didn't like. I also do a little trick. I don't know if Bob ever does this, but I ask to talk with one or more of their employees, and I ask them questions like, what keeps you up at night? What's your main problem? Where, you know, and I ask them for resources, and I go at it like that, and it just depends. Some clients, I really don't have to research much because I'm already pretty familiar with what they're doing. Other times, it's more. It just depends.
Very cool. Okay, so there's another one. This has to do with confidence. How do you know if your copy is good enough to actually send to the client?
Pat, you want to go first?
You don't. Okay. I suspect it's different for Bob Bly than it is for Pat McCord, but I honestly sometimes don't know. I send it off and I let them know, take a look at this, and then let's work on some revisions. You know, I and usually I hit the mark pretty well, but I'm not sure I have that much confidence, really, at all times. I will tell you, a little plug for Bob here, I read every one of his books on copywriting and printed off pages that I needed, so I use his information on how to go about this a lot.
Well, I have a cheat method to tip the odds that the client will be happy. I don't write the letter and then give it to them. I write first just some headlines. And I say, here are half a dozen or so headlines. What do you think? Which do you like better? And they either pick one or we work on one and modify it. Now we have the headline. Next thing I write, I don't write the letter. I write page one of the letter, the lead, and I show it to them. And they might like it or they might dislike it. And we talk back and forth. And then I rewrite it and they go, yeah, that's a good lead. Now when they get the copy from me, there's no surprises. They already have approved the headline. They've already approved the lead, which is the most important part of the letter. So the odds that they will like it are much higher. The most prevalent reason that clients don't like or say they don't like copy is not that your copy is bad, but it's not what they expected. It surprises them. With my method, there are no surprises.
That's terrific. And
you know, I do the same
thing.
I
just want to add in too, is that really goes to the collaborative nature of this type of work too. Like Bob, what you were saying at the very beginning, it's not an adversarial thing. It's not like, you know, they send you off and, you know, you don't get to see daylight or get food or water until you come back with perfect copy. It's a team process, and there's multiple drafts and lots of back and forth. So I love that that question was asked and how you answered it.
Thank you.
So I'm also getting questions about, of course, getting your first client, getting your first project, and I do want to say that every program that is published by AWAI, including the program, this is our main flagship program for copywriting, all of our programs include step-by-step instructions on how to land clients. We don't just give you the skills, because really, if you have the skills and nobody's going to pay you for them, it doesn't really make that much of a difference. So we do show you how to land clients. In addition, you get access to our job board, directresponsejobs.com. We are contacted weekly by companies who are looking to hire AWAI-trained copywriters. So we've put together this job board where they can post ads directly, and that way they can access you, you can access them. We really get out of the way. We want you to find as many jobs as possible and make your life as easy as possible in landing clients. That being said, when you're first starting out, you might have a different strategy than approaching a large company right out of the gate. So Bob's first project, brand new. I have experience, let's say, in the health industry. What would you recommend maybe my first move be to land my first assignment?
I would try to, as I said, like I did with the computers, try to get some credential in the health field. Obviously, you can't become a doctor, but you might be able to join, you know, let's say the Association for the Fight Against Leukemia, and therefore, if you go to companies that make cancer vaccines and cancer drugs, you have a little bit of a connection with it. You're not a professional, but they see you're interested. So try to get as many credentials in the field and education in the field, because if you're talking to a potential client, let's say in health, and they mention something about, let's say it's an assignment for a prostate supplement, and they say something that's very common knowledge about prostate supplements, and you're like dead silent because you never heard it before, that's bad. So do your homework first. If you're going to approach a client that sells prostate supplements, go online and read 10 websites for 10 other products that are prostate supplements so you know what's being done in the field.
Pat, what about you? What would be your advice for a brand new person looking to land their first assignment?
Rebecca, you're breaking up a little bit, but I think I know what you asked. How would I get that first client?
Yes.
I don't know that I am really good at this. I will defer to Bob on most of it. I've had all kinds of different ways I get clients, and honestly, an awful lot of it is word of mouth. It really is. One thing leads to another leads to another.
Excellent. And then I see we're at the hour, so I'm going to ask one more question of each of you. Bob, as far as coming up with a time for each project, and I know part of this just comes with experience, but when you're given a project by a client, how do you determine how long it's going to take you? to actually
do the assignment. This is what I tell clients. They ask me how long it would take. I said, if you could give me 4 weeks, you would automatically become my favorite client, and I would put you in my will. If you give me 3 weeks, that works very well for me. 2 weeks is really tight, but if we can see it a way to make it work, I would try to make it work. And if you need it in 1 week or less, I'm not the guy for you.
Excellent. And then I'm going to come back to both of you, if you wouldn't mind, with just final words before we close. But Pat, before I do that, if you could go back and do it all again, you had just met ADBI, you just decided that you want to become a copywriter, what would you have done differently?
I had two corporate jobs, but I would have had a – I'm sorry?
Go ahead, Bob, and then I'll continue.
I had two corporate jobs, but I would have had a corporate job with a direct marketing firm, because that ultimately was what I ended up becoming, a direct response copywriter, and my corporate jobs were not in direct marketing, so I had to learn it outside of the workplace. That's the thing I would do differently.
And Pat, what about you?
Well, I would do practically everything differently, but, you know, we don't have time for all that. Like I said, I've made every mistake in the book and still came out okay. Copywriting is worth learning to do if all you do is write your own promos for your books. So that is a skill that you can take any place. I would probably pick a niche much sooner and get more interested in one kind of writing and really become an expert on that. I was always more interested in fitting the copywriting in between my books and chapters and things like that. So I'm still learning. I've been at it for, I don't know, 9 years or something, and I feel like I'm still learning for sure.
Yeah, and I did the opposite. I'm always fitting my books between copies. So you can do it both ways, really.
But we are just getting so many great comments just saying thank you so much, such great information. They love the genuine answers and honesty. So thank you guys so much. Kate, I don't know if you were planning on wrapping it up, but I would like to hear final words from both of them, and I will keep answering questions by hand.
Yeah, let's do that. Bob, how would you like to say goodbye to our listeners?
This is going to maybe be an odd thing way to answer that question. To me, the secret of success in life is doing what you want to do, when you want to do it, where and with whom you want to do it. And being a freelance copywriter and a book author allows you to do that. And with copywriting, you have the money to finance that dream and to finance your book writing if you're like me, not a bestseller, and don't make a mint writing books.
Beautiful. Pat, how about you?
Yeah, I would kind of agree with Bob. It's all about deciding that you want to live your life your way. Long ago, I kind of chased trends a little bit and tried to say, okay, what do the publishers want now? What do they want next? I don't do that anymore. I write exactly what I want to write, and I don't worry about the rest of it because I've got a basic income.
Fantastic. Well, you're both inspirations to me and to Rebecca, and you so simplify what AWAI is all about, and the spirit of giving and generosity and learning and curiosity and sharing and just all those wonderful traits that I'm very appreciative to both of you for sharing with us today.
It's our pleasure.
Okay, Bob,
thanks.
And go take care
thanks
of that.
Thanks for having us.
Okay.
I will do it.
Thank you. All right. Bye, everybody. If you have
and you will be getting a playback link from Writer's Digest. A lot of you are asking me about playbacks of the recording. Writer's Digest will automatically send you an email with the link inside.
Sorry, fantastic. Kate. And thank you, Rebecca. I really appreciate it. I'm sure you were a lifeline to everybody that had all the great questions. So thanks. So bye, everybody.
Bye-bye.
Bye, everyone.
Bye.